begin at the beginning. It is spring, moonless night in the small town. Starless and Bible black, the cobbled streets silent, and the hunched quarters and rabbit's wood limping invisible down to the slow black, crow black fishing boat bobbing sea. The houses are blind as moles, though moles see fine tonight in the snouting velvet dingles.
I saw on the doorstep a young man who really did seem to be remarkably small. He looked very frail indeed, and he used to really rather work on this by wearing sweaters six sizes too large.
He wanted to be pale and dying all the time, and he wanted to be long and sickly and green and all that. In point of fact, of course, he was square and small and not like the conventional idea of a poet at all.
His name was absolutely mad, you know. It was dreadful. A drunkard and a womanizer.
I've never seen my father drunk. Ever.
He really loved sweets. Cat Lennon used to put dolly mixtures round the bath, you know, to persuade him to get into the bar.
And all the people of the lulled and dumbfound town are sleeping now. Begin at the beginning.
Or to begin at the end.
I loved a man whose name was Dick. He was big as a barrel and 3 feet thick. And I loved
the end, this bit of it anyway, was what Dylan Thomas wanted more than anything. To be revered as the great Welsh poet of all time.
But the one I loved best, awake or asleep, was little Willy Wee, and he's 6 feet deep.
This is the churchyard in Larn, southwest Wales, Anglican church, where Dylan Thomas was buried on the 24th of November, 1953. His wife, Catlin, who survived him by more than 30 years, chose, in spite of their famously quarrelsome marriage, to be buried beside him.
Her name is on the other side of this cross, a simple memorial to them both.
It's the only thing he ever thought to do, yes. I thought the only thing he could do, he was, from the very start, had just the one idea, that the poems and the booze.
Tonight's arena starts with the death of a famous poet and traces a backwards life from the grave to the cradle.
My mother was very much against him going the last trip, and he went from a third trip to a fourth trip, and for some reason, some devil sent him there. In himself.
Light breaks where no sun shines, where no seas run, the waters of the heart push in their tides, and broken ghosts with glowworms in their heads, the things of light file through the flesh where no flesh decks the bone.
The end for Dylan Thomas began 3,000 miles away in a blue-collar tavern in Lower Manhattan. Between 2 and 3:30 a.m. on the morning of November the 3rd, 1953, in this bar, Dylan Thomas consumed 18 straight whiskies. That's 18 English doubles rather than 18 English singles. He died 6 days later of what one doctor described as this severe insult to the brain. does this story sound familiar to you? I myself have read it in no less an authoritative source than the Rough Guide to Britain. It does sound exactly the way this wild, drunken Welsh poet might have died. The trouble is, it's almost certainly completely untrue. There were people in the bar that night, and none of them remember him drinking anything like that amount. The phrase severe insult to the brain first surfaces in this book, Dylan Thomas in America by John Malcolm Brinning, the fountainhead of the Dylan Thomas myth. This is the poet as pulp fiction hero.
He had had enough of public performance and enough even of his own exhibitionism. And in despair, he said, I've come to the melancholy conclusion that my health is totally gone. I've seen the gates of hell.
Now I am a man no more, no more, and a black reward for a roaring life, sighed the old ramrod, dying of strangers, tidy and cursed in my dove-cooed room, I lie down thin and hear the good bell's jaw.
On whirlwind tours from coast to coast, clowning outrageously, lionized, triumphant, yet miserable, he lectured, partied, drank and read. But in New York one evening, desperate beyond all recall, he went to a bar where, by his own account, he downed 18 straight whiskies.
This is the room in the Chelsea Hotel where his long, painful, lied-about death began. It was Brinning who introduced Thomas to the Chelsea. Unbeknownst to his wife, Kathleen, he was sharing the room with Brinning's assistant, Liz Rytel, the recipient of that boast about the 18 straight whiskies. Thomas's last days were stage-managed by an unholy trinity of American admirers, Brinning, Rytel, and this man. Milton Feltenstein was a pill doctor with a lucrative practice in Gramercy Park. Without taking blood or urine samples, he'd been giving the possibly diabetic poet injections of cortisone, benzedrine, and morphine. Feltenstein was notoriously coy about quantities. Indeed, he refused to discuss his treatment of the poet right up until his own death. But there's no doubt at all about the last shot he gave Dylan Thomas. It was half a grain of morphine, enough, under the circumstances, to send him into irreversible coma. The last thing he saw was his hotel room. He never regained consciousness.
And death shall have no dominion. Under the windings of the sea, they lying long shall not die windily, twisting on racks when sinews give way, strapped to a wheel, yet they shall not break. Faith in their hand shall snap in two, and the unicorn evils run them through. Split all ends up, they shan't crack, and death shall have no dominion.
Why are we so preoccupied with the details of Dylan Thomas's death? Why linger over this image of the overweight little man with the touchingly tiny hands who breathed his last surrounded by crowds of spectators? Sometimes up to 200 of them came in off the street to press against the glass at the end of the ward where he was lying. Well, he was something of a celebrity when he was alive, but his death made him a legend. I'm standing on the balcony of the boathouse, the place where Thomas and his family lived during the last years of his life. It's now firmly on the tourist map, a place of literary pilgrimage, in Larne, an idyllic small village by the sea.
when he was recovering from his trips to London or later on to the States, he would be in a state of collapse. And my mother would put him to bed and she would feed him milksops. In fact, when he finally collapsed, she said the trouble with these American women was that they didn't know how to look after him.
The nurse role almost immediately became my leading role. And quite early on, he said he wasn't going to do something, bloody well wasn't going to call so-and-so or whatever it was. And I said, Dillian, you really must. And then facetiously, I said, after all, as your nurse and your manager, I have the say in these things. To which she said, you're not my nurse, you're not my manager, you're my love. So that was the relationship.
My God, those American women are absolutely shameless. They were sending him flowers. They were all over him. That made me furious. You know, there was I slaving away in the bogs with my children, and there was he gallivanting up. And, you know, I was really absolutely mad with rage.
Dillon died on his fourth trip to America. As we go back in time only a few months earlier, we find him on his third tour, April to June 1953. These nationwide tours were exhausting. Though they helped to make him famous, they did nothing for his marriage or his already fragile health.
One fellow said to him, why, Mr. Thomas, have you come to the United States on this occasion? And Dillon said, in my eternal search for naked women in diaphanous Macintoshes.
He always turned up for his engagements. He managed that, but it was costing him too much because then he was required to entertain basically his hosts, go to parties, meet people, and then very early next morning, after inadequate sleep, he would be on the train or someone would be ferrying him to the next engagement.
He was being lionized and he was eating it up. Women throwing themselves at him, being outrageous whenever he had a chance to be.
I think what really did my father in on that last trip particularly, and the previous one, was that Time magazine had come out with an article depicting him as a sponger, a liar, and a thief, and somebody who pinched the bottoms of all the faculty wives, made passes at the students, and so forth. And of course then everyone's expectations were such that if he didn't behave in that way, people were slightly disappointed.
At times, he'd feel a sense of guilt. Getting his letters from Caitlin, he would forget sometimes to send money back when needed for the children, I hope. So he would send these poisonous letters. There was torment, yeah.
I'm writing this in Poker Flat Saloon, Sedona, Arizona, surrounded by genuine cowboys in 10-gallon Stetson and being treated to rye whiskey by a sheriff with two pearl-handled revolvers in his belt. Wish you were with us. Love, Dillon.
Mother still took the top of the egg off for my father. He did really absolutely nothing domestically. We had a desk up here in the sitting room. He would answer his letters and do all the sort of preparatory business of the day, which wasn't creative writing. Then he would go to his father and they would do the Times crossword. Then he would go to the pub, Brown's Hotel. That was 11 o'clock. He desperately wanted his father to approve his creative work. And he always showed his father his latest work. He was completely devoted to his parents. My grandmother was a very maternal sort of person, but she just hadn't had the educational opportunities that her husband, DJ, had had. DJ never smiled. He just wore a trilby to cover his baldness, and he was very severe, and I can never remember him ever smiling at anybody.
Old age should burn and rave at close of day. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Though wise men at their end know dark is right, because their words had forked no lightning, they do not go gentle into that good night.
Do not go gentle into that good night. This simple, half-Christian, half-pagan challenge to the power of death has a universal appeal. It's a villanelle, a 19-line poem with only two rhymes and a repeated chorus line. Not an easy thing to write in English, but Dylan Thomas was as precise as he was original about verse form. It was written in 1951 for DJ, his father, who was dying, a retired, defeated schoolmaster. But it's a look back over the poet's shoulder at a once terrifying figure, an old-fashioned atheist who'd shake his fist at God and the mess he'd made of the world.
Dylan used to come in. He used to come in every day, and they used to do the Times crossword. That was the starting of the day, always. And then Daddy's, he would beat him as regards knowing the old masters, you know, quotations and so on. But, of course, before the end, Dylan got as good as and better than Daddy then.
Grave men near death who see with blinding sight, blind eyes could blaze like meteors and be gay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. And you, my father, there on the sad height, curse, bless me now with your fierce tears, I pray. Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light.
Dylan's father was a teacher in Swansea Grammar School. And then he retired and he came to Larne and he lived in the Pelican just across the road. Very temperamental man.
Mm. Not very nice.
No, he had a terrible temper with him.
Did he? Yeah. You were around in Larne when Dylan was living here?
Yeah, well, I'm only 72.
And so you remember him quite well?
Yeah. I worked in Victoria Bakery. And he used to pass there every time we used to go home to the courthouse. And we had quite a few chats in here. And that's all I can ever remember him drinking here, were half pints of beer.
Just half pints?
Yeah.
So he never seemed drunk to you or kind of...
Oh, yeah, he'd have a few, right? But, well, he was one of the boys. Like, you know, he used to get involved with everybody.
When my mother was interviewed in her life, when she emphasised the home life of my father over the public one, people were not happy at all. And I found the same when I start going on about my father's routine and how he never drank when he worked and that the drinking was always of a very, very temperate nature. People, first of all, don't believe me. Secondly, don't want to believe me. And they want my father cast as the icon. They want him to be this terrible person that can be warned against.
Thank you.
There one goes, unsullied as yet in his Pullman pride, toying, oh boy, with a blunderbuss bourbon, being smoked by a large cigar, riding out to the wide open spaces of the faces of his waiting audience.
When that light came up on him, all the lights came on, and it was the most beautiful, inspiring, fantastic performance.
The Welsh body, the voice, was very special, the golden voice. As a sculptor, I felt that he was doing things with words that I hadn't found in other poetry.
We weren't used to that kind of thing. You never get that ass-licking in England and so on. He adored it, he loved it. I don't blame him. I was probably very envious and resentful.
Dylan, will you read me some poetry tonight before you and Kathleen go home?
Pleasure. I'll read a poem of my own and then one or two poems by other people.
In the mustard seed sun, by full tilt river and switchback sea where the cormorant scud, in his house on stilts high among beaks and palavers of birds, this sand-grain day in the bent bay's grave, he celebrates and spurns his driftwood 35th wind-turned age. Heron, spire, and spear.
I couldn't regret marrying Dylan, because that's an experience in a lifetime. And he was a marvelous person. Let's face it, it's just that I didn't want to share him with anybody. But you can't expect me to have someone who's made for everybody all for myself.
Dylan made the second of his four trips to America, the one that immediately preceded the Undermilt Wood journey, in 1952. They arrived on January the 20th and stayed for 4 months. In the first leg of the tour, he did 26 performances in 47 days. Grueling. But the most important thing about the trip is that it was the only one he took with Kathleen. People are still taking sides in this marriage. What tends to get forgotten is that these two people could not leave each other alone. They were in love. Kathleen survived him by more than 40 years and left no less than three accounts of the relationship after Dylan was dead. But though she could be seen as both progenitor and participant in the Dylan Thomas myth, the fact is that she was genuinely concerned for him. And she paid him the supreme compliment that, unlike the campus groupies, she never made the mistake of taking him too seriously. There's a wonderful story of a posh dinner party in Carmel in California. As people are clearing their throats, ready for Dylan to start singing for his supper, Kathleen growls, and now I suppose we'll have some poetry. The public theatricality of their rows was actually designed to keep people out.
How did he write poetry? Was it easy for him or difficult?
No. It was terribly difficult. He used to go into his little shed and scrape and scratch and mutter and mumble and intone and change. And he was frightfully slow, you know, in one whole long afternoon from about 2 to 7. He might have done just one line or taken out one word or put in one word.
When at readings he introduced his beautiful lyric poem, In My Craft or Sullen Art, Exercised in the Still Night, he used to say, this poem's a complete fraud. Actually, I work in the afternoons like everyone else. And he did work. He wrote and rewrote, often using a thesaurus to find exactly the right synonyms. He's said to have produced up to 200 separate and distinct versions of the same poem.
Not for the proud man apart from the raging moon I write on these spindrift pages.
nor for the towering dead with their nightingales and psalms, but for the lovers, their arms round the griefs of the ages, who pay no praise or wages, nor heed my craft or art.
I never trusted him. No, I didn't, because he was a typical Welshman. And a thief and a liar. Taffy was a Welshman, Taffy was a thief.
Most evenings after work, Dylan would return to the pub, this time with Catelyn. Their drinking sessions invariably ended badly. Catelyn knew about the other women in Dylan's life, and he knew that she too had been unfaithful.
I beat the Jesus out of him. It was always after the pubs. You know, just before getting into bed kind of thing. I threw myself at him, or caught a hold of him and just bang him on the floor, and so I was really quite nervous myself that I might have killed, you know, knocked him out. I think we probably sort of got into bed and passed out, and then when we came to, we were all kind of all over each other and very tender and apologetic and all the rest.
The roadside bushes brimming with whistling blackbirds, and the sun of October, summery on the hill's shoulder. Here were fond climates and sweet singers suddenly come in the morning, where I wandered and listened to the rain ringing wind blow cold in the wood far away under me.
The first time that Thomas went to America was from February to June 1950. What did they make of him? What were they expecting? A spokesperson for poetry, the spinster's friend, as Thomas himself described it, or something a little more exciting? To make a legend, you need material. Dylan Thomas's great subject was Dylan Thomas. And on that first tour, which was a huge hit, on one occasion he was moved from a 300 to a 1,000 seat auditorium, he created something uniquely modern out of what he once called the small, bone-bound island of himself. Readers had had Eliot's religion and Auden's Marxism. Now they had a new hero, one who was to prove an inspiration to the Beats, Bob Dylan, and the Beatles. A small, apparently rebellious, drunken Welshman who, while not afraid of sexual profanity, preached the sacredness of individual perception, raged against systems and money, and saw heaven in a grain of sand.
She puts up with.
Never should have married.
She didn't have to.
Same as her mother.
There's a husband for you.
There is his father.
And you know where he ended?
Up in the asylum.
Crying for his ma.
Every Saturday.
He hasn't got a land.
Carrying on.
That Mrs. Beattie Morris.
Up in the quarry.
And seen her baby.
It's got his nose.
Oh, it makes my heart bleed.
What he'll do for drink.
He sold the piano.
And her sewing machine.
Falling in the gutter.
Talking to the lamppost.
Using language.
Singing in the W.
Poor Mrs. Waldo.
Off stage in the house, he just liked his warm slippers and his dish of titbits and pickled onions and sardines and anything with a lot of vinegar and cockles, all put on a plate which he'd stuff into his mouth when he was listening to the cricket scores. He was just Mr. Everyman until he put on the act of being the poet, or until he wrote his poetry.
Previous to his first trip to America in 1950, Thomas's principal platform had been in London and BBC Radio, then in its heyday.
This is the British Broadcasting Corporation.
In everything that concerned the spoken word on radio, he was impeccably professional. One gets rather tired of unending stories of his drunkenness, which was often imposed upon him by his hangers-on. In my own BBC experience, he was invariably sober and conscientious during rehearsals. I've known him leave his fellow drinkers in a pub at lunchtime in order to get back to the studio and study his part before the afternoon rehearsal.
I remember I met Dylan in our nearest BBC pub, and he was drinking half a pint of bitter as usual with a cigarette jutting out of his mouth. "Hello, boy," he said to me, "I got an idea for the radio. It's all about a village that was mad. You hear people talking in their sleep and dreaming. Is it worth 50 quid advance?" I said, "Yes." He said, "No." And I said, "Yes." So I took him over to the copyright department and got him 50 quid advance.
Half a pint, half a bit.
We continue on our backwards journey. The American chapter of Dylan Thomas's life has not yet begun. But at home, BBC Radio has made him a household name. Thomas has come to be viewed as a kind of ancient Celtic bard, but actually, he's one of the most modernistic poets of the 20th century. He loved the microphone, he loved film, he loved detective stories, he loved being on. So who was this man who died so tragically in a New York hospital? An obscure, drunken, penniless poet? He wasn't, actually. As we go backwards through Dylan Thomas's life, we find that in the late 40s, he was a British media star, whose drink of choice was a half pint of bitter. He was a key broadcaster in BBC Radio's legendary sound features department, nearly all of whom drank in this very pub. Between 1945 and 1953, he wrote or appeared in nearly 200 radio broadcasts and even made a television appearance, now, sadly, lost to us. He was a man with a reputation among his peers, a reputation for reliability.
Over Sir John's Hill, the hawk on fire hangs still. In a hoisted cloud, at drop of dusk, he pulls to his claws and gallows. Up the rays of his eyes, the small birds of the bay and the shrill child's play wars of the sparrows and such who swan sing dusk in wrangling hedges.
I came to see that there were two halves to him. There was the very serious, mature poet, who matured terribly early. And there was also, I think, the little Welsh boy who never grew up. If you regarded Dylan as a toddler, I mean, toddlers are dirty and noisy and everything, but you love them. And Dylan had very much that endearing quality.
Before that first trip to America, the family had only 9 months in the boathouse. Catlin described it as the last happy period of their lives. The boathouse had been paid for by Margaret Taylor, wife of the Oxford historian A.J.P. Taylor.
People talk a lot about Dylan's borrowing and stealing, but quite a lot of people sponged off him. When Dylan was in the money, he was incredibly generous.
Dylan used to worry terribly about it, even sleepless nights about the money. It just, that really accumulated and got worse, and the bills and the debts and all that. But of course then he got this patroness, Margaret Taylor, you know, and she helped us more than anybody. Without her, I don't know what we would have done, because she bought us various houses, put us up also in Oxford in a little studio place in the grounds and so on. He was quite prepared to pay the price to these patronesses. If they wanted to go to bed with him, he was going to do it.
Dylan said, "I'm terribly worried about money. How about giving me a contract?" "Oh," I said, "I don't suppose there's any contract you would keep, except perhaps one you wrote yourself." And I pushed the menu across to him and said, "Write your own contract, and I'll see if the BBC can back it." All right, he said, and this is what he wrote. Clause one, £10 a week to be paid direct to Caitlin for the groceries. Clause two, must live in Wales. Clause three, must come to London 2 days a month for a piss-up. Clause four, don't pay me anything till I've written it. He said, that's one I'll keep. And I believe he would have, but I could never persuade the BBC to take it seriously.
During the Second World War, between 1940 and 1945, Thomas was a scriptwriter for Strand Films. It was the only job he could get. He didn't want to join the army and kill people. He wrote documentaries about the home front, and he wrote poems about the effect of the war, like Among Those Killed in the Dawn Raid Was a Man Aged 100. He wrote that one on a scrap of paper in 10 minutes in a cutting room. It was these poems, collected together in Deaths and Entrances in February 1946, that finally made his reputation. These were poems that were not just experiments with words, they were about something. And they went down very well with the literati who hung out in the square mile behind me, between Regent Street and Broadcasting House.
Among those killed in the dawn raid was a man aged 100. When the morning was waking over the war, he put on his clothes and stepped out and he died. The locks yawned loose and a blast blew them wide. He dropped where he loved on the burst pavement stone and the funeral grains of the slaughtered floor. Tell his street on its back, he stopped the sun, and the craters of his eyes grew spring shoots and fire when all the keys shot from the locks and rang.
Thomas was relieved of the need to register as a conscientious objector because he was classed C3 as a physical specimen. When the war began, he and Kathleen had been married for 2 years. During the war, they had their second child, Aronwy, and lived an existence financially precarious and unsettled, half in London and the home counties, half in Wales.
The first time I met him was in Swansea during the Blitz. I remember him reciting Milton in a pub, and people who had never heard of Milton listened with awe and begged him to go on.
For some reason, uniform absolutely infuriated. John Pritchard told me that he was walking past the Swiss, was it, one time, and Dylan came rolling out through the blackout doors, and Kathleen came after him, and she said to John, if only Dylan would just once pick on a little man. Uniform infuriated him.
My mother and father led a nomadic life. I went and sponged on different people at different times, but it wasn't considered sponging, it was considered they would enjoy him.
And they went down very well with the literati who hung out in the square mile behind me between Regent Street and Broadcasting House. Stalking a dead writer can be a cumbersome business, sifting through the evidence, accounts written or recorded at the time, recollected in tranquility, decades later, each witness with their own take. In the case of Dylan Thomas, does anyone have the whole story? And does any of this help us to understand his work?
You see, he was such a good poet, and he liked to behave like a bad one. And he was such an ethical man, and he liked to appear totally unrespectable.
With Dylan, Dan Jones said Dylan preferred lies. He liked lies because they were more interesting. He thought the truth was very often very dull.
But more people were draining his energy and draining in his cash, you know, because he didn't have much, but he spent it when he had it.
A lot of people would like to have a continual party for their life without the consequences. And just to read about my father and to imagine him having a continual party and producing great works, it's nearly as good as doing it themselves.
He gave a great feeling of both health and unhealth, of someone who was ruining himself, whose teeth were gone, who couldn't eat breakfast, who had awful sort of hangover pains, talked about pain and joy, and of health, of a marvellous, captivating energy. So it never occurred to one that he was burning himself to pieces exactly.
I think he did compartmentalise his friends. I know sometimes I've come out of the six bells in Chelsea with Dylan, and this is a long time ago, of course, he is about 20, and some friends of his were walking on the other side of the road, and he would leave me and go and talk to them.
There's only one thing on which they all agree. He was always true to his own sense of himself as a poet. What is it about this man that provokes such disparate testimonies? Did any one of them really understand him? There's no question that the person who was most central to the contradictions in his life was his wife. Kathleen McNamara was born in London of Irish parents, with a background altogether different from Thomas. She was brought up in the country, in Hampshire, among art and artists. They met in the Wheatsheaf pub in London in 1936, shortly after the publication of his second volume, 25 Poems. He was the bohemian poet, she was the poet's girl.
There he was, talking away as usual. Yes, he kind of fell all over me, you know, put his head on my knee and never stopped talking. And it seems almost immediately that we kind of fell into bed together. All happened so naturally, as though we'd known each other all the time.
Kathleen and Dylan Thomas are one of the great literary love affairs of all time. The irony is he wrote hardly any love poems to her. The most important one, originally entitled Poem to Kathleen, was called I Make This in a Warring Absence. And it's basically a poem about a row. Couldn't live with her, couldn't live without her. It's also, and this is a point we can't make too many times, incredibly obscure and difficult to understand. His friend, Vernon Watkins, said it took him 3 weeks to write the third verse alone, and 3 or 4 days to change the last line of that verse from proud as a mule's womb and huge as insects to proud as a sucked stone and huge as sand grains. Was this 3 days well spent? But deliberate density of syntax was a Thomas trademark long before he met Kathleen. He'd already published his first collection, 18 Poems, in 1934. And where was he when he wrote those poems? His hometown, Swansea.
I wonder whether you remember a friend of mine.
Hmm. What's his name?
Young Thomas.
What's he look like?
He'd be about 17 or 18, and about medium height. I'm above medium height for Wales, I mean. He's 5'6½". Thick blubber lips, snub nose, curly mouse brown hair, one front tooth broken after playing a game called Cats and Dogs and the Mermaid Mumbles. Speaks rather fancy, truculent, plausible, bit of a shower off. Plus fours and no breakfast, you know. Used to have poems printed in the Herald of Wales. There was one about an open-air performance of Electra in Mrs. Bertie Perkins's garden in Sketty. Lived up the uplands. A bombastic, adolescent, provincial bohemian with a thick-knotted artist's tie made out of his sister's scarf. She never knew where it had gone. And a cricket shirt dyed bottle green. A gabbing, ambitious, mock-tough, pretentious young man. And Moley, too.
There's words. What you want to find him? Thought I wouldn't touch him with a barge, followed you, Mr. Griffiths. Mind, you can never tell.
Sound Welsh, did he? I don't think he... I never thought of him as being... sounding Welsh.
He caught the lilt of Welsh because it was all around him. He caught the hoyle, that powerful sing-song of the old-style Welsh preachers, now, alas, almost gone from the Welsh pulpit. And Dylan, curious enough, although he never spoke Welsh, was probably the last great practitioner of the hoyle.
Wales is a foreign country. They do things differently there. Some people see the Welsh as poor relations of the English, even going so far as to think it's perfectly okay to make racist remarks about them, as did Dylan Thomas's wife. Insulting the Welsh has become a kind of English hobby. Thomas's parents would have spoken Welsh at home, but his father did not want the boy to grow up learning the language. He felt that being Welsh-speaking would have impeded the boy's progress, a commonly held delusion of the time. And Thomas, when you hear him, doesn't sound particularly Welsh. He cultivated a kind of classic English actor's voice, the one you hear on the recordings. He once described himself as a poor man's Charles Lawton. But don't be fooled by that. Dylan Thomas was Welsh, all right.
Once he was with his Swansea friends, he was relaxed in a way that I don't think anybody ever saw him. You know, in those days, he was laughing. And when Dylan laughed, he used to hug himself like a child and laugh uproariously so that he couldn't stop.
Because we were always afraid of what our parents would say when we got back and explained we'd been out with Dylan. If you could paint Swansea red, we painted it a very pleasant colour of red, and Dylan was the chief painter.
I didn't really like Dylan Thomas's poetry in my 20s. I thought his work was lacking in rigour, the kind of stuff that ends up on tea towels. I don't think that way now, nor do a lot of other people. If you put Thomas's name into a search engine on the World Wide Web, you'll get around 270,000 hits for Dylan, and for W.H. Auden, you'll get around 120,000. Dylan Thomas is the most familiar, most famous poet of the 20th century.
He knew exactly what he was doing from the very beginning. He had no doubts about himself. He often thought he was going wrong, taking the wrong turning, but he had no doubt that in the end he was going to be a very important poet.
He had very literal mind. I mean, when I first met him, he described the work of revision he did on his poems as very like plumbing, getting things in the right position and so that they function properly.
There was, when he was very young, something very romantic about being ill and dying young. He told me that he was tubercular. He'd been to see a doctor who'd given him only 6 months to live. None of this being true.
Well, as regards English, he was always top. But as regards everything else, he didn't bother.
He didn't go on to university?
No, he wouldn't go. He said there were, well, when his dad used to ask him, he used to say, well, there's no need of it.
He could put on that coy look with those big, wondering eyes of his and those little bubble curls he had in those days, and he'd look so innocent. And then suddenly he'd start to smile. He had a cracked tooth which gave him almost a Satan look. You know? Suddenly you could see that there was that the angel was a wicked angel.
One of the things that I remember most of all about Dylan is his tremendous sense of fantasy weaving. For example, we could be involved for hours, even days, on problems like how many mice it would take to pull the Flying Scotsman from Glasgow to Euston.
The only person he was afraid of was his father. And the rest of the masters he treated with a rather pleasant form of contempt.
Dylan probably played truant as much as he attended school. When Dylan felt like pushing off, he just climbed over the school wall and was gone. The fact that his father was senior English master acted as no break upon that at all.
His father was my English master. Dylan's father himself was a very remarkable man, a great scholar, tremendous appreciation of English literature. He used to talk to us boys as if Chaucer was an old boy of Swansea Grammar School. He made things vivid, exciting. And he had a touch of Dylan in him. I think he felt towards the end that Dylan had fulfilled all the ambitions that he, Dylan's father, could have done if he'd really applied himself to it.
We've seen the young poet, encased in talent like a uniform, struggling his way out of obscurity, in both senses of the word, to become a respected and comparatively well-paid public figure. We've seen his much-mythologized romantic persona, difficulties with women, with money, difficulties with drink, and the potent image of his death, as insidiously glamorous as Keats's consumption or Shelley's drowning. But remember, it's only a handful of lyrics that most people know. which certainly don't include Alter Wise by Owl Light or How Shall My Animal? Why did he influence John Lennon and Bob Dylan? Is it just that there's something rebellious about his attitude? Was it just sex and drink and not having a proper job? Well, he found his lyric gift when he was very young. And Death Shall Have No Dominion was published when he was only 19, long before he was accepted by the literary establishment. When a young man's thoughts turn to love and death, and he can express himself as powerfully as Dylan Thomas, his reputation is made. The heart of the Dylan Thomas story is in his beginnings, which is why we decided to tell it backwards. Its secrets lie hidden a mile or so north of here, in a quiet suburban street in the Uplands district of Swansea.
And I came to the shops and houses of the Uplands. Here and around here it was that the journey had begun of the one I was pursuing through his past.
Having been taught English at the grammar school in Swansea by Dylan's father, my memory is of an extremely irascible teacher, very impatient, and could be quite cruel, but a magnificent reading voice. He was happy when he was reading or quoting. And he did this quite magnificently.
Behind the school was a narrow lane where only the oldest and boldest threw pebbles at windows, scuffled and boasted, fibbed about their relations. My father's got a chauffeur. What's he want a chauffeur for? He hasn't got a car. Dylan described himself as the Rambo of Cwmdonkin Drive, and this respectable house in the Uplands, the cosy Swansea suburb, is where he was brought up.
Oh, he started about eight, I should think.
Really?
8 or 9, yeah. Well, he started a poem on that own, yeah.
Children all day capered or squealed by the glazed or bashing sea, and the steam organ wheezed its waltzes in the threadbare playground and the waste lot where the dodgems dodged behind the pickle factory.
And, you know, he'd ask his sister sometimes, he'd say, what shall I write about now? And you know what sisters are, they're not very patient with their brothers. And he'd say, oh, write about the kitchen sink. He wrote a poem, most interesting little poem about the kitchen sink.
In this room on the ground floor, his father, given to wearing a hat in the house to hide his baldness, retreated to his books.
It was then in my father's brown study before homework that I began to know one kind of writing from another, one kind of badness, one kind of goodness.
But you couldn't keep all his stuff he was writing because, well, I'd have had the house full. We wouldn't have had a room to live in.
His mother and I were big friends, you see. He was mischievous. Oh, he was a terror. Nice boy, though.
And I went up through the white grove into Cwmdonkin Park.
Though it was only a little park, it held within its borders of old, tall trees, notched with our names and shabby from our climbing, as many secret places, caverns and forests, prairies and deserts as a country somewhere at the end of the sea.
Dylan Thomas once said he had all the disadvantages of a happy childhood, a perfect time that's gone and will never come again. He was also blessed, or cursed, with perfect recall, the kind that seems to plague so many writers, which is perhaps why childhood, along with death, is one of his great subjects. His language, too, is like that of a child, a concern for words, for their sound as much as for their sense. The tragedy of Dylan Thomas the man is that he never managed to escape the charmed playground of his childhood. He never really grew up, and in one sense, never saw why he should. His triumph as a poet is that he never escaped seeing the heaven that lay about him in his infancy.
Oh, as I was young and easy in the mercy of his means, time held me green and dying, though I sang in my chains like the sea.
The child he was the child he became. There was a cost involved in that. He paid for it with drink, with hard currency, with damaged loves and friendships, and finally, with his life.
Now, he was born in 1914. Well, during the First World War, I used to come in, you know, I'd been down to the Uplands shopping, and I'd say, Dad, do you know who's gone to the front today? Well, then he would go, Dylan, as a little boy, and he used to go to the front and couldn't understand where the people were.
The only front I knew was the little lobby before our front door. I could not understand how so many people never returned from there. But later I grew to know more, though still without understanding, and carried a wooden rifle in the park and shot down the invisible, unknown enemy like a flock of wild birds.
He was a very delicate little boy. As a young boy, he was extremely delicate.
This bedroom was the best bedroom. Dylan was born in here. The mystery at the heart of the Dylan Thomas legend is simplicity itself. It's a complicated business to write as clearly as Thomas did at his best. Poems with the directness of vision of a young child.
As well, see, when he was very small, I used to say to his daddy, oh, Daddy, don't read Shakespeare to a child only about 4 years of age. He doesn't understand this. And he used to say, well, he'll understand it. It'll be just the same as if I was reading an ordinary thing.
For me, if the answer lies anywhere, it lies in this room, and in the picture of a small boy lost in the wonder of words and his own imagination. Dylan Thomas knew one big thing, poetry. It was the only place where he was completely honest. It was the only thing to which he was completely true. It was in his beginning, and to use the biblical symmetry of so much of his language, it was in his end. He died asking questions about the placing of an apostrophe. For poetry was his first love, here in this room, and it was his last, in that other place, where he died so alone, on the other side of the broad Atlantic.
Soon the bell would ring for the closing of the gates, though the park was empty. The park keeper walked by the reservoir where swans had glided on his rounds. I walked by his side and asked him my questions, up the swathed drives, past buried beds and loaded, utterly still, furred and birdless trees, towards the last gate. He said,
oh, yes, yes, I knew him well.
Dusk drew around us and the town. I said, what has become of him now?
Dead,
the park keeper said.
Yeah. You had no trouble in entertaining him, because to give him plenty of notepaper and pencils, he'd go into his own little bedroom and he'd write and 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 write.
Simon Armitage talks life, language and music with fascinating guests including J.K. Rowling and Chris Packham in his podcast series The Poet Laureate Has Gone to His Shed. Download BBC Sounds to listen. ¶¶